And so, just a small introduction. So what do we know about conformative theory in four-dimensional zone? So we know a lot of abstract theory, which has been constructed in the 70s. So we know the notions of scaling operators, operator product expansion, conformal partial wave decomposition. But the trouble is that all this beautiful theory is essentially laying there without much application, because we have very few known examples of conformal field theories apart from supersymmetric examples. Well, some examples we do know, we have some hope that these things exist. For instance, we have hope that if you just take a gauge theory with a certain number of colors and a certain number of flavors, so that it's asymptotically free in the UV, then there is a conformal window for this theory. So for a certain number of flavors, this theory, instead of confining in the infrared, is going to flow to an infrared conformal fixed point. So why do you know that? Well, we have an evidence from large N, so for large N expansions, and it's been discovered in a paper which has been written a few months, as far as I understand, after the discovery of asymptotic freedom as such. Then we have evidence from supersymmetric examples, and we also have evidence from simulations in lattice QCD. More particularly, if you take three colors and 12 permanent flavors, then it seems that latest QCD people can show that this theory doesn't confine, so it flows into the strongly interacting scale invariant theory in the infrared.
Is it normal that the critical number of flavors is a function?
For 16 and a half flavors, you lose asymptotic freedom. And for 8 flavors, it seems that you don't yet have these two confined. So it's between 8 and 16. So the trouble is that we have no theoretical control about these fixed points, which seem to exist. So why do you want to know more about these fixed points? Well, for several reasons. First of all, it's just curiosity. But more importantly, we hope that perhaps conformal field theories and scale invariant theories in four dimensions may play some role in nature. So there are some examples which are discussed in the literature. So for instance, there is this issue of unparticle physics, which is basically, it's been discussed since last year, since 2 years ago. This is kind of wishful thinking physics. But there are some more motivated examples where you would like to invoke conformal symmetry. So in a very thought-provoking paper in 2004, Lutin Deku introduced this notion of conformal technicolor. And people are trying to use conformal field theories to construct supersymmetry breaking sectors with some nice properties. So these are my motivation to look into these things. So in particular, I'd like to spend some words to tell you about this beautiful idea of conformal technicolor. So this is the best possible theory of electroweak symmetry breaking that you can imagine. So what's the idea? So in the standard model, the Higgs field, so the only field that we have not yet discovered in the standard model, it has dimension 1. And it's good and bad at the same time. So it's very good for the theory of flavor, because since the Yukawa couplings are dimensionless in this picture, you can imagine that if your theory has a very high ultraviolet fixed point, it explains beautifully why this picture, the Yukawa couplings, explain all flavor effects that we have ever observed in flavor physics. Because the four firm interactions which can describe unwanted effects like flavor changing neutron currents, they just decouple like 1 over lambda squared. On the other hand, it's bad to have fundamental elementary Higgs, free Higgs, because your theory has a relevant operator, dimension 2 operator Higgs field square, which in an effective field theory picture is supposed to be present in the lower energy Lagrangian with a large coefficient, with a coefficient as large as the ultraviolet cutoff of this theory. So you find that actually taking lambda v to infinity as you would like to do to decouple flavor effects is problematic. So this, of course, the hierarchy problem, this is how you view hierarchy problem from the point of view of conformal field theory. So, in the usual technicolor picture, so you try to resolve the hierarchy problem by taking as a fundamental Higgs field a fermion bilinear, which has dimension 3. So in this case, you solve the hierarchy problem, there is no relevant single scalar operator in this spectrum. On the other hand, you fail miserably with flavor physics, because now the Yukawa couplings are supposed to come from this operator, which is technicolor Higgs suppressed by the 2 powers of the UV cutoff. And this operator is just as relevant as the 4-Fermi operator, which is supposed to contribute to all kinds of unobserved effects. So there's no way you can explain, or at least in a natural way, you can explain why we don't observe any of these effects. So in order to resolve this tension, there is this idea of conformal technicolor, which is based on an earlier working technicolor idea actually from Hall from 81. So the idea is that if you want to have a theory which is good in flavor physics, then the dimension of Higgs be better close to 1. Because then the Yukawa couplings are going to be almost dimensionless, so you can carry over all the successes of flavor physics from the standard model. On the other hand, if you want to solve the hierarchy problem, then the dimension of H dagger H better be close to 4 or above 4. In this case, you eliminate the hierarchy problem. So, here is the question. The question is that we don't know of any such theories, of course. And the question is this thing at all possible, or is there is any, if there is any deep reason from conformal field theory, which just tells you that it's not possible to have small anomalous dimension for H and large anomalous dimension for H dagger H. So that's the question that that I would like to discuss. So actually, so this is a formalization of this same very question. I take an arbitrary unitary conformal field theory, and in this theory I take a Hermitian scalar operator phi. I take its OPE. So phi times phi, which is going to contain a unit operator, and it's going to contain, it's going to contain some scalar operator. And I'm going to concentrate on the leading scalar operator in this OPE, which I can call kind of phi squared, quote unquote. So this is just a name. And then there can be all other operators present in this OPE. There can be, there's going to be, of course, car spin operators like the energy momentum tensor, there are going to be other scalars, there are going to be spin 3 fields, spin 4 fields, whatever. So they can all be present with arbitrary coefficients. I don't make any assumptions about that. So the question I'm interested in, if there is any upper bound on the dimension of the leading scalar in terms of the dimension of phi. And in particular, is it true that if the dimension of phi goes to 1, becomes close to 1, then the dimension of the leading scalar is supposed to become close to 2. Of course, if I can show that, this potentially, depending on the numerical significance of this behavior, it can be, it can rule out the idea of So, of course, I'd like to recall the unitarity bounds, which are the lower bounds. So they tell you that in any unitary CFT, all scalar operators have dimension necessarily bigger than 1. And if the dimension is exactly equal to 1, then such a field is free field. There's a theorem of unitary CFT. So in this case, of course, if the theory is free, then we know what's the O, what O is. It's phi squared, and its dimension is exactly equal to 2. So in this sense, you expect that if the dimension of phi comes close to 1, then at some point, the hierarchy problem is supposed to strike back. And the question is, how early does that happen? So, if anything like that is true, then it's a fundamental property of conformal field theory, and it should be, it should follow from prime principles of conformal field theory. And if you know the conformal field theory, then you realize pretty quickly that the only weapon that you can use to attack this problem is conformal bootstrap. So, conformal bootstrap is a consistency condition for the OPE and crossing symmetry, which is known since the early days of conformal field theory, since the 70s and 80s. And the trouble with this condition is that it has not borne much fruit until now, because it's a complicated condition. So generally, you will have infinitely many fields contributing in this channel, infinitely many fields and dimensions and spins with unknown coefficients, with unknown OPE coefficients. So you get a system of equations for infinitely many variables, and it's not clear what to do with it. So apart from some particular situations in two dimensions, this equation has not been of much use so far. And okay, and nevertheless, you can get a germ of an idea how to proceed. So the idea is that in this OPE, there is always the unit operator present, so it's always going to contribute to this OPE. And the contribution of the unit operator to this OPE by itself is not crossing symmetric, so it doesn't satisfy this relation. So just 1 divided by x12, x34 is not equal to 1 divided by x14, x23, where these are two points, 1, 2, 3, 4. So the exchanges of scalars and higher spins should restore the crossing symmetry. And the hope, actually the only hope in this business, is that somehow higher spins cannot do it by themselves. So if higher spin fields cannot restore crossing symmetry by themselves, then you can get a bound on the dimension of scalars. So that's the hope. And that's the miracle, because that's exactly what happens. That's what we discovered. So this is a technical step. It's a very useful technical step. It's called known by conformal block decomposition. So essentially, in this crossing symmetry, in this conformal bootstrap condition, you can resum the contributions of any primary operator O and all its descendants. So you can call this contribution conformal block, which depends on the dimension and spin of the exchange operator here. So this is a general expression for a four-point function of four identical scalars. Consistent with conformal symmetry, is determined up to a general function of two conformal cross ratios u and v. And this function guv is represented as a sum over conformal blocks, which, as I said, depend only on the dimension and spin of the exchange primary, and the coefficients of these conformal blocks are the squares of the OPE coefficients, because it enters twice. So a very important thing is that these OPE coefficients, you can show that they are real numbers. So it's a consequence of unitarity in this case. And so these numbers are positive real numbers, the squares of OPE coefficients. So this is going to be important. And another thing, very important thing, is that in this case, in the case of four identical scalars, only even spins contribute by both symmetry. And also that there are this unitarity bound. So I said that for scalars, the unitarity bound is the dimension of any scalar is bigger than one. And for higher spins, there is a somewhat stronger unitarity bound, delta bigger than L plus 2. For instance, the dimension of stress tensor is 4, so it saturates the unitarity bound for spin 2. Okay, this is an absolutely fundamental thing for our approach. It turns out that four-dimensional conformal blocks are known in closed form. So for any delta and del, this conformal block has been computed in closed form as just products of some hypergeometric functions. And an interesting thing is that you are supposed to make a transformation from the variables u and v, from the cross ratios, to this variable z and z bar by this formula, z equals z bar and v equals y minus z1 minus z bar. So this z is actually a generalization of the two-dimensional z to the four-dimensional situation. So you can do it like that. If you send one point to infinity, and if you put two points x1 and x3 at two fixed positions in the four-dimensional space, then okay, there is a rotation symmetry around this axis, and if you fix this rotation symmetry by putting x2 into a plane, then the z is just a conformal coordinate in this plane. So this position of x2 with respect to x1. So this is the meaning of this variable. And okay, coming back to the crossing symmetry, the issue becomes if we can balance the crossing symmetry deficit created by the unit operator. So the crossing symmetry in the 1-3 channel tells you that this function g of v has to satisfy this equation. And if you separate the contribution of the unit operator and you put it on the left-hand side, so we call it the crossing symmetry deficit, and in the right-hand side you put the contributions of all other operators, be it these coefficients L lambda delta L squared. So the question is whether you can balance both things, both sides. And it's actually convenient to divide by the left-hand side and express everything as a sum root. So you get that the sum of these functions f d delta l with the coefficients lambda squared has to be equal to identically equal to function 1. And the question becomes, suppose that you make certain restrictions on the spectrum of your theory, then it's not guaranteed that there's going to be, that you can find these coefficients lambda squared knowing that they're positive, so that this sum rule is going to be satisfied. So that's the idea. So you have to show that under certain conditions, under certain restrictions on this spectrum, the sum rule is just not satisfied. Okay, this is supposed to demonstrate how sum rule converges in the free theory. And these are our results. So it's a rigorous theorem which we proved with Riccardo Rattazzi, Eric Toni, and Alessandro Bicchi. And the theorem says that a greater product expansion phi times phi must necessarily contain at least one scalar operator, one primary scalar, of dimension less than a certain function of the dimension of the operator phi. And this function, we computed this function numerically. Nevertheless, it's a rigorous, in spite of the fact that numerics intervene, it's a rigorous bound. So this is this function. So I'd like to indicate its salient features. So first of all, if you make a fit, numerical fit to this function, then you get that near, so if you approach the point phi goes to 1, the free field point, then this bound goes to 2. It means that necessarily the free field theory limit is approached continuously. So this region is excluded, so there must be an operator which has dimensions smaller than 2 in this limit. As you deviate from dimension phi equal to 1, then there is first a square root behavior with a certain numerical coefficient, but then it kind of asymptotes to a linear function which goes somewhat above the trivial relation that you might expect in a non-interacting theory in which the dimension of O is just twice the dimension of phi. So you see, for instance, that when the dimension of phi reaches 1.7, then the bound reaches kind of the value of numerically. So it's numerically interesting bound. It's not just some bound like 1,000, which nobody would care about. So I'd like to spend just 1 minute. How can this at all be possible, you may ask? Well, what turns out is that essentially, so this is an example, you pick one dimension for the scalar phi, 0.1. And then you start plotting these functions that enter the sum rule. And you just do some numerical study, so you plot them by mathematical, whatever you want. And what you discover is that if you look at the spin 2 and spin 4 contributions, and also higher spins, you notice that all these functions, they have their convex functions near the self-dual point, near the middle of this interval x1, x3. They all have a positive second derivative. On the other hand, all functions have to sum up to the function identical equal to 1. So the sum of all second derivatives has to be 0. So how can this happen? It can happen only if a scalar can help. And if you do the same thing for scalars, you notice that also scalars with high dimensions have positive second derivative. Well, then the whole thing cannot be consistent. So it can only be consistent if there is a scalar with small dimension, and scalars with small dimension indeed have negative second derivative. So this is just a very simple, this is a very trivial example. if you want to obtain this bound that I showed you, you have to do a much much deeper study, but essentially this is the main idea. You look for certain positivity properties which are satisfied by the derivatives of this this conformal block on these conformal blocks. Everything follows from that. Then of course there is no how to find these properties. And this is another here I confront the bound which we found in four dimensions with an analogous bound that we found in two dimensions. And why is this interesting? Because in two dimensions, in four dimensions we don't have any examples of these four dimensions of these CFTs. But in two dimensions we have many examples. We have, for instance, the minimal model CFTs. And you can ask how do they behave with respect to our bound? What you find is that the easing model, it almost saturates the bound, and also the higher minimal models, they almost saturate the bound. So if you wish, if we didn't know about the easing model, then we could discover the easing model just by looking at this plot and noticing, gosh, there's something funny going on at this point. There must be a conformal field theory hiding here. So of course that's the hope. The hope is that there are also some four-dimensional theories which saturate or nearly saturate this bound, and we hope that one day they're going to discover them. Okay, I'll skip that and I'll just go to the to my conclusions. So the conclusions is that we have discovered that there is a certain gold mine of results which apparently can be brought to light using a very ancient weapon, conformal bootstrap, provided that you wield it in the correct way. So I talked about some bounds on the greater dimensions that you can derive. And there are some other bounds on the bigger efficiency that you can also derive with very similar methods, but that's still work in progress, and who knows which other constraints on conformal field theories can be got in the future.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Questions?
Can these bounds be attributed to some kind of density matrix positivity, or what is the reason?
Density matrix positivity. You use density matrix positivity in order to derive the unitary bounds on the greater dimensions. But here, it's more than just that. I think here, since you're using OPE, it's kind of unitarity comes together with locality, which, and it's it, and as a resulting constraint turns out to be stronger than each of these two things separately. So I don't think it's just the positivity of the density matrix, because these conformal blocks, they satisfy unitarity separately, each one by one. So it's more than just that.
You assume that there is no level of quantum?
No, I don't assume that there is no level of quantum.
There is also no
because my argument is not perturbative. I don't assume that the theory has to be connected continuously to any to conformal field theory, for instance. I just analyze one point in theory space. And I make statements about this particular point in the theory space.
Well, in this case, in other words, you don't assume that you might have degeneracy. You can have several fields.
If there are degeneracies, they are of no problem for my argument. Okay. Because they just have to be taken.
Last question.
Can I get a bound on the minimal dimension, so scalar operator, of the first scalar level? Because I know people discuss this in two dimensions.
Just on the first scalar.
Yes.
Well, I know what you're referring to. You're referring to this paper by Henneman.
Yes.
So Henneman wrote a paper that in two dimensions, he got a bound on the dimension of the first primary scalar, just by using in terms of the central charge of the theory, by using modular invariance. Here, I'm doing something else, because in order to start my argument, I have to assume that there exists already one scalar, and then the whole machinery starts. In general, that question could be asked also in conformal field theory, or in four dimensions, that question of Hellerman. But I don't know how you would attack it, because modular invariance that he used in two dimensions is not operational in four dimensions.
But if you look at four-point function of four-step sensors, maybe you could get some bounds on that.
Yeah. That's a good point. Yeah, perhaps you should. Yeah, since we assume that could be provide a hook, some non-trivial hook in order to start the whole procedure. That's a good point.
Well, I'd also myself. I'd also like to ask more questions, but unfortunately we really have to cut because it's getting late. I was asked to make an announcement for those of you sort of to be rewarded for having kept until that late. I would just to remind you, I would just ask to remind you that at your hotel there is such a thing as breakfast, and it starts at 6 o'clock in the morning. So those of you who travel from the east will probably find it very reassuring to be able to eat already at 6 o'clock in the morning. Now, our session is over, so let's thank the speaker again.
I also heard that breakfast finishes at 5 p.m. So it can also